I'll start my talk. The title of my talk is The Computational Design of Protein Structure and Function. Well, the reason I talk about the protein, my talk and Tangia talk all talk about protein and protein interaction design, that's because we know that in synthetic biology, the modules or the parts, if you want to design modules or parts, then we have to do with protein design. And the known protein structures already provide us a lot of building blocks for the module design in synthetic biology. But if we want to design new modules, we have to understand what's the relationship between a protein sequence and the structure and the protein-protein interactions or protein and the DNA interactions. And if we look at the growth of the protein structures in the protein data bank, along with the rapid development of structure biology or structure genomics, we observe an exponential growth of protein structures. But if you compare this finger, well, this is the word like. If we compare the left finger with the right finger, this finger shows the increase of the number of folds, new folds, in the CASI protein classification database. If we compare these two fingers, the increase of new folds actually is currently very slow, and this curve actually is almost reached the plateau. So the question is, have we discovered all the protein possible protein structures? Or that's because in structure biology, we only solved the easy protein structures. And all the other possibilities that in nature, somehow that in our current world, we only select a few sets of protein structures. And in another probably hidden world, we have other possible set of protein structures. So the questions we are asking is that the first one is, can we computationally discover new folds? Or can we predict new folds theoretically? And can we design a stable protein that folds to the new folds? So that's related to that the fold problem. Can we discover new folds? And based on this, can we use the collection of protein, of course, the existing protein structures, as well as new folds if we design many of them, the collection of protein structures to design new protein-protein interaction pairs. So let me start from the discovery of new folds. If we talk about the protein design, talking about the new folds, there's one very famous example from W. Baker's group a few years ago, the protein was designed with a novel fold, the protein called TOP7, and this protein is a new fold, but this fold is human designed by intuition. And if we want to systematically to design or discover protein new fold, of course we cannot do this manually. We have to have some theoretical basis, have to have some computational ways to discover new fold. So what kind of theoretical basis we should go in order to design, to discover new fold? One of my collaborators, Professor Chao Tang, actually he's now a professor at UCSF. When he did this work, was done when he worked at NEC Research Lab. They have studied the relationship between protein sequence and protein structure, and they discovered that many stable protein structures, well, the light is cannot be seen easily. Many of the stable protein structures corresponding to numerous number of sequences. So if we look at these different protein structures, some of the structures corresponding to many more sequences, but some of the protein structures corresponding to a less sequence. So they call this, they produce a principle of a protein designability. The the basic conception of a protein designability that the protein structure we observe today, the stable protein structures, they should correspond to more sequences. So that might become evolution, because if this structure is robust, corresponding to many structures, then it's kind of easy to be selected during evolution. So we start from this. Of course, 10 years ago, they only used a lighting model. And if we want to discover a real protein structure to design a real protein structure, we should go beyond the lattice model. So recently we collaborate on this project. We went further with more realistic model. We use either off lattice model. We use three dihedral angles in order to reproduce the protein backbone structure, and we also use extract fragments from the protein data bank, and try to use all the possible fragments to calculate the designability of all the fragments. And for the designability calculation, as we need to enumerate all the possible structures, so currently we only play with small proteins, and. For a small protein, it's around 30 amino acid residues, and we carried out the designability calculations. And from if we check the highly designable protein structures, we can see a lot of familiar structures. For example, here is the helix helping structure. It's quite common in protein structures, and we can observe the zinc finger structure. And also bait structures with three anti-parallel bait strands. And one of these structures actually caused our attention is this one in the red circle. This structure contains an alpha helix in the middle. Do you have a pointer here? My pointer. It's not light enough. Anyway, do you have a pointer here? This one seems not strong enough. Right one is better, yeah. So this structure have alpha helix in the middle and two base strands connected by the alpha helix. So the two bit strands actually form a parallel bit sheet. And this kind of motif actually is quite common in large proteins, in alpha slash beta protein structures, like this is a tin barrel structure, and it's beta alpha beta sandwich structures. It's quite common, but we don't know why. If we cut out this standalone motif, this motif have never been found in nature. So, well, we don't know the reason, but we guess that probably because this small protein, it kind of tend to aggregate because it's very small. The hydrophobic core may not be easily to be stabilized. And the other possible reason is that during the early days of evolution, we can observe these small protein structures. But then, because this small protein structure tend to aggregate, then they form a through the evolution, they form various types of large proteins. Anyway, we chose this small protein structure as our design target. And then we did a real protein design. We start from a knowledge-based design of secondary structures. We first design a stable alpha helix. We already know a lot of, from previous protein structure design studies, we already know a lot of rules. We know how to design a stable alpha helix. And then we try to design a stable beta strands. And after we design a stable secondary structures, then we do automatic hydrophobic core design. And this kind of design actually use a computer program, try to pack side chains inside the hydrophobic core. And then we get the first generation of protein sequence. And actually, in the field of protein design, we cannot we cannot see that if we design sequence, that sequence should work. And it's kind of iteration discovery cycle. So after we design first generation sequence, we needed to do experiments and then go back to modify our design. So after the first generation design, then we try to stabilize the alpha helix. We introduce like NCAP and different known strategies in order to stabilize this alpha helix. And then we introduce a pair of tryptophans on the base strands in order to make the parallel beta sheet stable. And then we get a stable structure, but unfortunately it's still a dimer. And the last cycle is that we try to design a monomer. And then finally we get a stable monomeric protein with the desired fold. So after this kind of computation and experimental iterative cycle, actually, of course, there are many cycles. After many cycles, trial and error, and the computations, we finally get a stable protein. This protein shows where go the secondary structures in the CD structure, and shows in the gel filtration, it looks to be a monomer, and the protein is very stable thermally, and also quite stable against the chemical denaturation. This is the chemical denaturation curve, shows that this small protein unfolds cooperatively. And we solved the solution structure using NMR. And from this overlapping of backbone structures, we know that this NMR structure actually is quite well quite well conserved. This protein have very conserved secondary structures. And if we look at the final structure, the NMR structure we got, and in fact, this small protein has a conserved hydrophobic core with a phenylalanine ring and packed with other aliphatic side chains. And so it's a well formed hydrophobic core. And we introduced the tryptophan zipper on the parallel beta. We observed the zipper formed here on the beta sheet. And we also introduced two positive charges in order to do negative design, in order to prevent the protein from aggregation. So we can observe that this positive charge and this positive charge, they cover the hydrophobic core. So that's what we have designed. If we compare our AMR structure with the design targets, actually, the secondary structures overlap quite well with the root mean square deviation about 1.7 astrons. From this design work, what we have learned from the design of this small protein with the alpha beta structure, we have shown that this kind of theoretical calculation, designability calculation, actually can be used in identifying novel protein folds. Of course, currently we only play with small proteins, and in the future we are trying to apply this method into much larger proteins. And as I said before, this small protein actually it's a motif in large proteins. But why we cannot observe it now in nature? That's probably because of evolution. So this kind of highly designable motifs might be the fossil protein structure evolution. And of course, because we have successfully designed this small protein, we have learned a lot about this kind of structure design. So the lessons we learned for this particular protein structure design is that we needed to design a very stable helix, and we needed to introduce a pair of tryptophan zipper for the stabilization of parallel beta sheets. And it's quite important to do a negative design in order to avoid aggregation. So after the structure design, of course, the next step is in synthetic biology, we may use the new modules we designed, the new protein we designed, or we may use the natural protein already exist in order to design new protein-protein interaction pairs. So because for the de novo design, we only have one structure now. So we start from natural protein folds. In the protein databank, we already have like around 1,000 different protein folds can be used. And if you want to design a new protein-protein interaction pair, let me analyze the protein-protein interface first. We know that the protein-protein interface actually is, compared to protein ligand, it's pretty large. It's normally around 1,500 square astrons, and involves a lot of residues on each side. It's around 10 to 30 residues on each side. But in many of the systems, not all the residues play the same role. If we analyze different roles of the radius on the interface, for many of the cases, we can only identify 3 to 4 key radius. So that's a key radius that contribute the most to the stability of protein-protein interactions. And of course, for interface, they should have like a geometric, hydrophobic, and an electrostatic complementarity. And there are some very interesting observations that one is the convergent evolution. That means that two proteins evolve from different origin, but finally they have a similar structure, similar function, sorry. Different structures can have a similar function. And one particular protein structure can have different functions. So that's the lesson we have learned from nature. We have different structures with the same function, or the same structure with different functions. Can we use this kind of observation? So we start from trying to design a new protein interaction pair that use trying to change one protein in the pair. That means that if we already in nature we already have a protein interaction pair A and B, and we try to change this protein A into another protein. And this protein we call a scaffold protein. This kind of thing can be done because I already said that because protein functions in many of the cases are mainly determined by local surface radius. And there are many protein structures available in the protein data bank that can be used as protein skeletons. And we already know in nature that some of the protein with the same structure but with different functions. So we can use a naturally occurring protein structure to make them have another new function. So our strategy is that we start from a known protein interaction pair we call the target and the ligand. We try to move the function from this ligand protein onto another skeleton protein. So the requirement for this kind of skeleton protein is that this skeleton protein should have available position to accommodate the functional site. And the skeleton protein should also form complementary interactions with the target. And then we start, this is a cartoon showing that originally we have this kind of interaction pair, and we search the whole protein data bank to another protein structure that can have the same position to accommodate the functional site. So we start with the carbon alpha and carbon beta vectors, and then we also match the key interaction atom pairs. So we start from try to analyze the interface first, identify where are the key residues, and then we search the protein data bank for possible protein skeletons, and then we do molecular superposition and try to optimize the position of optimize the new protein interaction pair. And then this is all the optimization. And then after we do the mutation of the functional site, we may need to do further mutations to optimize the interface. So as a first step, we need to know where are the key interaction sites. We use a computer program developed in my group a few years ago to analyze the hotspots at the protein-protein interface to identify where are the key interaction residues. And then after we know where are the key residues, and we can do a vector superposition with, for example, like we have two residues on the ligand protein. We search all the protein structures in the protein band to see if we can find some protein that can accommodate these two vectors. And after this step, of course, we also add the superposition of key atoms. And then we try to calculate the complementary score between the two proteins. And then we need to adjust, to do the position adjust. And after we mutate the key interaction radius, we may need to do additional mutations. The commonly used strategy in proteins actually is the protein side chain packing. If we have a protein structure, we can all the 20 amino acid radius, they have different rotamers, and we can try to put on different rotamers and in order to determine what kind of conformation of this particular protein radius should take. And of course, there are various tools for side chain packing calculations. My group also have one computational tools using genetic algorithm to do the, we use not the fixed rotamer, but we allow the rotamer to be mutated around the fixed rotamer. And then we optimize the interface, and we need to calculate the benefit energy in order to know which mutation should be the best one. So as you know that if we use a force field calculation, it's not easy to accurately calculate the benefit energies. So we take a different route that we use a static potential, and we're also trying to combine the static potential with other terms, empirical terms like the contact size and the packing density, etc., to make a combinatory score to calculate the Benefit energies. And after all the preposition, then we should work with a real biological system. One of the examples that we are working on actually is the aspirin protein, the EPO binding with its receptor. So as showing here, that one EPO molecule binds to two receptors. And we try to design another protein that can replace the EPO, either activate the receptor or the or inhibit the activity of EPO. So the EPO and the EPO receptor signal transduction pathway actually it's pretty complicated and not only involved in to stimulate the growth of red blood cell. Recently, this pair was found in many cell types and have other quite complicated biological functions. So we start from here, try to design a new protein that can bind to the EPO receptor. The binding of the EPO with the receptor, actually one EPO protein binds to two receptors. The two sides are different, so we start from this stronger side. And after analysis, we identify like there are two key radius that can form hydrogen bond, another key radius that can form hydrophobic clusters. And then we did all the computation, as I said before, and we selected the many different possible protein structures. So it's kind of interesting. You can see that from this slide, many different kind of protein structures that can bind to the EPO computationally. Of course, we have to verify this experimentally. We chose one particular protein structure, and this protein is a pH domain from phospholipase C. So this phospholipase C actually is intracellular in this kind of signal transduction pathway. But anyway, this protein in nature it's kind of independent with the EPO pathway. They cannot meet. They're different pathways. So by doing, if we use a domain from this protein, I think it's quite safe that we do not observe any crosstalk. We can design orthogonal protein interaction pairs. That's very important in synthetic biology. So we start to play with this protein. This is the complex structure of the pH domain with the EPO receptor, and this is the design interface. So we did experiments. We made all the possible mutations. We made a single mutation, double mutation, and this is our design target, a three-point mutation. And we tested, of course, before we test the binding, we should make sure that the structure still keep the original structure. And then we test the binding. In this finger, shows that at the same concentration, different protein mutants bind differently. And one of the strongest is our design target. In the SPR binding assay, the in vitro binding constant is around 20 nanomolar. That's pretty strong. And then Of course, we compare the binding constant with the, our calculated free energies. Well, they correlate quite well. And then we did the in vivo activity test using a eukaryote system of the apple stimulated the JAK-STAT pathway. And if you use a purified protein, that protein shows an IC50 of around 6 micromolar. And so from this design, what I have learned, we learned that in the protein-protein interaction, many of systems that the key radius do contribute significantly to binding. And of course, other factors like shape complementarity, packing, binding affinity, or electrostatic also contribute to the binding. And we already show that we can design a new protein. Well, another protein, we make the protein to bind with the EPO receptor. Of course, the same strategy can be used in other system design. We are currently working with other protein interaction pairs, trying to apply this kind of strategy in a new module or new interaction pair design in synthetic biology. So I'll summarize my talk. I have talked about two topics. The first one that we show that novel protein folds can be discovered theoretically and designed through computational experimental approaches. And novel protein interaction pairs can be designed and applied in new module design in synthetic biology. And I would like to thank the people who are doing the work. For the first part of de novo design, it's one of the graduate students, Huanhuan Liang, she did the most of the work. And for the protein interaction design, the EPO project, it's Dr. Shen Liu and Dr. Xiong Liu, they did the EPO work. And Dr. Hao Chen, a former graduate student, he did the computational work for the designability calculation. And the de novo design project was a collaboration with Professor Chao Tang at UCSF and Professor Chen Zhen at Washington University. I also would like to thank the funding agencies and all the other members in my group. Thank you for your attention. Well, I think the time is pretty short. We can take like one or two short questions.
What software do you use in the hydrophobic core packing process? Which specific software?
You mean for the de novo design, for the hydrophobic core calculation?
Right.
Yeah, we have a homemade in-house program.
So it's not public available. Is it free available or not?
Yes, some of the program is available. Okay. You know, in protein design, actually, well, depend on what kind of protein structure we are working on, sometimes you have to tune the parameters. So for the one set of parameters, of course, we have one program available.
Okay, I have one question. For your de novo design, you designed the EPO. Design a new ligand for the EPO receptor.
Mm-hmm.
Then, how do you assess the affinity between the novel structure you designed and the EPO receptor?
Yeah, I may not make this clear. We use the surface plasma resonance as an in vitro assay.
Okay.
So we immobilize the receptor and then try to test the binding constant of the new protein. And we also use an in vivo test.
Okay, so you are using SPR method.
Yeah, in vitro is SPR.
Yeah.
And in vivo is luciferase expression.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.